In this episode, I present a variation of the powder bed fusion process, multi-jet fusion. While powder bed fusion is among the oldest processes that was invented end of the 80s, there's new players on the block that are driving improvements and also challenging these processes and really moving the whole technology along by pushing it a little bit. And one of these processes that has made a mark and is now a commercially available, highly used process is multi-jet fusion, which is a variation of polymer powder bed fusion. At the bottom here, you see a schematic that was released by HP, a white paper when they announced this process. And it shows that material is recoded, similar as we have now become familiar with the other powder bed fusion processes. And then an inkjet printing technology is used to first apply a fusing agent and then a detailing agent. Fusing agent is applied, is black and thermally conductive and is applied where the part is going to, where the powder is supposed to be melting, and the detailing agent is applied right next to it at the edge where the part isn't supposed to fuse. That means once we see that here we have the gray detailing agent and the black fusing agent, so once infrared light is coming at, as our heat source, the black ink is absorbing that energy and fusing the powder particles together where they're supposed to form the part, and the detailing agent is helping us to keep the other areas unfused. So you can get very good boundaries and distinction between the areas to be fused and the part cake. Advantages are that you need no support structures. You can manufacture parts in standard plastic with good mechanical properties. Parts are almost isotropic, so very comparable to polymer powder bed fusion. But the process is a little bit faster. HP claims that it's 3 cm/h compared to 1 cm/h in powder bed fusion, which makes it more cost effective and is really pushing and challenging the cost of the other processes a little bit. Features can be as small as 200 micrometers. And then disadvantages are that the powders are also expensive. The parts are black because of that fusing agent. And there are full color prints, but they result in weaker mechanical properties, so not the same strengths that you would get from the other parts. Similar to powder bed fusion, tolerances and surface finishes are good, the powdery surface, but not as good as, for example, VAT polymerization. And we see sink effects where we have rough surface areas due to the dispensing of agents. And here you see examples of applications, can be used for prototypes, support parts, and small series parts. Here you see that buckle for a backpack or something else. I have the same as a demo part that I got for class at UW-Madison. This is a helmet for babies and toddlers to support the growth of their of the head in the right shape. And then here are some examples of colored prints. This cast is obviously the pattern for the fun of the wearer, of the patient. And then here you see examples that have the QR code included because it can be in color, and also some color features that could indicate where a connection should go or other things that should happen with the part. I don't have any of these, but I have some examples from Dimension here. That is actually polymer powder bed fusion, so a nylon 12 powder in different colors. And that is a dyeing process that's performed afterwards. So the full color print to date with powder bed fusion process is only possible with multi-jet fusion. However, you can also post-process all these parts. I mentioned sandblasting is something that's often necessary, but the other surface finishing operations and post-processing steps that can be done to get a color, get it more smooth, and other features that you like. In this quick episode, I'll summarize the material science of powder bed fusion. To summarize, what we've heard about powder bed fusion is that One of the things that's super important is getting the powder coated for the next layer, flowability and properties related to that, and then the melting and crystallization behavior is super critical to understand how to select material, how to design your process, and the properties of the parts that you will get. For example, shrinkage, warpage, dimensional changes. We'll talk more about that in the advanced series.